Let's head back to the days of fun. Just watch the podcast until it's done. Thanks for tuning in to Pop Ninja.
To the Pop Ninja Podcast, where we reminisce about the pop culture of the 70s, 80s, and beyond. From bell-bottom jeans to parachute pants. From Panama Jack shirts to members-only jackets. From Smurfs and Scooby-Doo to Thundar the Barbarian. If you had a Rubik's Cube, wore a Swatch Watch, was crazy about Max Headroom, or ever wondered who shot JR, then this podcast is where you will feel right at home. Now, jump in the DeLorean time machine and join your hosts, Lisa and Patrick, as they take you on a pop culture adventure through the greatest decades of all time.
Hey everybody, welcome to the Pop Ninja Podcast. This is our Halloween special edition. I'm Patrick Bennett, coming to you from the swamps of Louisiana. And with me over Zoom is Lisa Everett, my co-host. Hey, Lisa.
Hey.
How's it going?
Good.
Good?
You can call me Cinderella. Yeah.
Cinderella. Cinderella. Spiderella.
Spiderella.
Spiderella. All right.
Yeah. Call me Spiderella.
Cool.
Yeah.
And you can call me Indy. Even though you named the dog Indy.
You can call me Indy. We could be Spindy. Cinderella and Indy. Spindy.
Cool. So what do we have today to talk about?
We're going to talk all about Halloween.
Halloween stuff? So Halloween scary stuff or something scary. That kind of ties in with Halloween?
Yeah, spooky stuff.
All right. So I want to talk about a movie first.
Okay.
And, I was telling my daughter today how you seem to like all of the slasher type movies, and I like all the monster movies. You know, that's the kind of horror I like, is mainly the monster and creature type films.
Hey, I just watched The Wolfman the other night. I like monster, but these kind of obscure movies. You like, I swear, like sci-fi.
Not necessarily. If there's a monster or a creature like out in the, like a Bigfoot movie or like Creature from the Black Lagoon, that's the kind of stuff I like.
What's the
something
stuff?
With a monster in it?
That movie, The Stuff, that you just watched. What? I never even heard of that.
The Stuff. Yeah, that was a weird one.
Oh my God!
He just knocked over myself.
So you're talking about all your movies that you're watching on the 31 Nights of Halloween?
Oh yeah.
Oh, I like slasher movies, and you like, I don't know what.
The monster movies, like monsters, yeah.
But these are like things I never heard of, like. Name the last few movies that you watched, because I didn't see any.
Well, the last ones were slasher movies. One of them was one of your favorites, the He Knows You're Alone.
You watched it?
Yeah, that was my one for yesterday.
I didn't see that. See, I was gone, so I didn't see what you watched. But you had Chud in there and The Stuff, and I saw you did My Bloody Valentine. I've seen that in Fright Night. Yeah. Okay, but now you want to talk about Pumpkinhead, right?
Pumpkinhead. Okay. I'll tell you right now, Pumpkinhead is my favorite like 80s horror movie. It came out in the late 80s. It was, I forgot what year. I think it was 87 or 88 maybe. But that is my favorite horror scary movie that I watch every Halloween season.
Frey raising the dead ain't within my power.
Will it be all right? Should I be afraid?
It's coming!
Looking for an old woman. She lives somewhere in the mountains hereabouts.
All she can do is take you straight to hell. You go home and you bury your boy.
Some folks say is how she's got powers.
Who are you?
Ed Harley.
What do you want, Ed Harley? Say it. You're looking for vengeance. Vengeance. Say it. There's no graveyard way back deep in them woods. The thing you're looking for is in there.
It was an accident.
It's gotta run its course. Now it begins. It begins. It begins.
Have you ever seen it?
Nope.
And it has a monster in it. That's what I like. Because, my favorite, like the old Universal horror monster movies, you know, with Dracula and Frankenstein, Wolfman. My favorite is Creature from the Black Lagoon. And
okay.
But anything with a monster in it, I'm there.
We like that Creature from the Black Lagoon because he's swamp.
Yeah. Swamp. Oh, yeah. Yeah, but I like him because he's a creature. You know, Dracula looks human. I mean, the Wolfman turns into a werewolf, but he still looks kind of humanoid, you know, human. But
did you ever dress up like any of those people for Halloween?
Dracula.
Did you?
Yeah.
Did you ever dressed up like the Creature from the Black Lagoon?
Well, I have a mask, and I had one of the guys that played the creature. He signed the mask. I thought that was kind of cool.
Okay. What about Swamp Thing? Do you like those?
I love Swamp Thing.
Yeah, I like the first one.
Yeah.
The second one
was kind of silly.
Yeah.
But I did like that first one.
Yeah, I did too.
Yeah, we'll talk about Swamp Thing in one of our episodes because, I love Swamp Thing.
Okay.
But back to Pumpkinhead. But you need to watch Pumpkinhead. I think you would like it. And I'll tell you about it. It's about this country hick kind of dad. They're up. I don't know where it was shot, but they're up in like. They call them the hollows and stuff. I don't know where it takes place, but it's a lot of hills and a lot of thick woods, a lot of fog. It looks real creepy. Uh-huh. And he's this hick dad, and he runs this like little convenience store out in the middle of nowhere. And these city kids that ride dirt bikes, they ride out and they stop at his store on their way out to ride these dirt bikes and buy, you know, groceries and beer and stuff. Well, they unload all their dirt bikes out in front of the store, and they're jumping heels and they're playing on their bikes. Well, Lance Hendrickson, his little boy is at the store with him, and his little boy goes outside to watch him. And anyway, long story short, the boy gets ran over by these motorcycles, and they kill him. So Lance Hendrickson just comes unglued, and he takes the boy's body. And he seeks out this old witch that lives in the hollow, and he gets her to summon the demon of vengeance. And everybody in the hollow calls this demon Pumpkinhead.
Uh-huh.
And they do like a little witch ceremony where he uses his blood, and the witch, you know, conjures
the little boy's blood.
No, the dad and the dad's blood. Lance Hendrickson, but everybody in this hollow knows when Pumpkinhead is summoned to go inside and lock your doors and don't come out for anything until it's over. And what Pumpkinhead does, he's a demon of vengeance. So if you have something you want avenged, you summon him, and he like basically hunts down all these kids that had something to do with the death and kills them one at a time. And it is cool. Pumpkinhead is the creature himself is awesome looking, very scary looking. And just the whole scenery of the fog and the thick woods and the hills. And it just looks so cool to me. I love it.
And okay, I have my Pumpkinhead now.
Yeah, you're going to have to watch it. Now that they made two sequels straight to video, and I didn't watch them. I heard they weren't anywhere nearly as good. So I skipped those. But watch this. You know who Lance Hendrickson
is, right? he's really well known, so that's a good person.
Yeah, and he was like in Aliens. He played the robot, the android.
Yeah, he was in The Terminator.
Yeah, he's been in a lot of stuff. He had a couple of series, too.
Wasn't he in Near Dark?
Yeah, yeah, he was.
Okay.
And he had a couple of series.
I've never seen that either.
One was called Millennium, like a sci-fi series.
Yeah, he's in lots of stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
So now I think I want to watch it.
Okay, well, I'll tell you, it was directed by Stan Winston. You know who Stan is?
No.
He's like a super famous special effects makeup artist and stuff. He does a lot of monsters and stuff. He worked on the effects for Terminator, Terminator 2, Predator, Jurassic Park, Iron Man. He did all the effects, the designs of the costumes and the creatures and stuff. Also, all the effects on Manimal. He worked on Manimal. He was the main effects guy. But he did the effects on Billy Idol's Shock to the System, that video. You remember that?
No, but we're going to talk about Billy Idol, though, so that's going to connect us to that.
Okay. Yeah, he directed Billy Idol's video, which is like a mini movie. It's kind of like a little horror movie, a little sci-fi horror movie. But so he's a well-known effects guy, and this was the one and only live-action feature film that he directed. And he did a really good job. He should have directed more movies, but he passed away, so, you know, it's kind of sad a few years back. But anyway, if you haven't seen Pumpkinhead, this is the perfect time of the year to watch it. So, you need to find it and watch it. It's awesome.
I gotta get it. I'm going to order it when we get off of this. I'm going to get Pumpkinhead,
Oh, hey, I want to tell you something about my costume.
Okay.
I've got, even got my little adventure bag here. And I'll show you what's inside my adventure bag.
Okay.
I've got an artifact.
Okay.
I want him a too soon. Remember that?
That's the title. I thought that was what you were gonna pull out. If you pulled out something else, it wouldn't have really gone with the whole Indiana Jones. You have a whip?
I do, somewhere in here. I have one hanging on my shelf.
Did you have this costume or did you go get this for?
Oh no, I've always had this.
You had this? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So anyway, that's all I got to say about Pumpkinhead. It's just an awesome movie.
Okay, well, kind of like I'm going to talk about Halloween 3. Okay, there's a Pumpkinhead in there in one of the costumes. So there's a kind of transition. What happened?
No, go ahead.
That was spooky. Okay, like a ghost, whatever that was that tipped that thing over is coming to get you. Yeah, don't look over your shoulder. Yeah, there's what your sleeve stack coming to get you. Well, okay, so I'm talking about Halloween 3, Season of the Witch, which is from 1983.
Listen, he just walked up out of the rain. I swear to God, that's all there was to him.
Did my father say anything to you the night he died?
I don't know. Your father came into the hospital. I thought he was crazy, out of his mind. He's hanging onto a Halloween mask. He wouldn't let it go. And what he said was,
they're going to kill us. All of us.
And in a little while, he was dead. And I don't know what the hell is going on.
I've been doing some detective work. I think my father ran into trouble somewhere between here and Santa Mira.
Santa Mira, founded in 1887, Colonel Cochran converted it into a toy factory.
You happen to know anything about this Cochran?
He's watching you, friend, I guarantee you that.
Where are they taking her?
They're taking her to the factory.
I've got nothing here to indicate there was ever a body at all.
Operator, this is an emergency. They're gonna kill us all.
I do love a good joke, and this is the best ever. A joke on the children. But there's a better reason. You don't really know much about Halloween. Halloween. Between the real and the unreal. The dead might be looking in.
You've got to believe me!
The last great one took place 3,000 years ago when the hills ran red.
Witchcraft.
Do I that signals a way of controlling our environment.
Stop it!
The world's going to change tonight, Doctor. I'm glad you'll be able to watch it. And happy Halloween. Halloween 3, Season of the Witch, the night no one comes home.
Did you see it?
I did, but I don't remember much about it.
Okay, I just watched the other night, so I got a refresher on it. So, but I watch it every year, and people think that it's supposed to be like a sequel to the first two Halloween movies, but it has nothing to do with Michael Myers.
Right.
So that's why people like dump all over it, because they think that it should be, like a trilogy, I guess, you know? So there's no Michael Myers anywhere in it, except in a scene where they're doing, I don't know if you know the storyline at all, is about, it starts out with this guy ending up in the emergency room. And the doctor, who's played by Tom Atkins, he is working the night shift when they bring this guy in, and he's holding on to a Halloween mask. And there's like these really cool masks that I keep wondering if they were ever like manufactured, you know, for costumes, you know, for around that time period, or where they got them, because they are really cool. And they've got a little Halloween like disc thing on the back of them that's like, he said the man that is the bad guy in it, his name is Conal Cochran, and it's like an Irish like company. The company's called Silver Shamrock, that they make these masks at. And there's like a disc thing on the back, and when it's activated by them, they flash this pumpkin on the TV screen, and that's what activates the thing in the back of the mask. And then like the people's face splits open, and you know, snakes come out and spiders and stuff, and it's gross. I mean, the special effects in that are really gross. And the thing is that John Carpenter, he never meant to make all these Michael Myers movies. I mean, he wanted to make movies about Halloween, you know, not just you know, the Michael Myers slasher movies. He just wanted to make a horror movie that took place on Halloween. So this one is, it stars Tom Atkins. He's the main character. He's the doctor in it. I don't know if I said that yet.
I like him.
Yeah, he's in a lot of John Carpenter movies, because he's also in The Fog. And the thing that I found out today when I was kind of researching some stuff about this movie, you know, like, because it, John Carpenter, he uses all these people in movies that he must be friends with in real life. And then he uses their real names as characters in his movie.
Yeah.
Like Nick Castle is the character in The Fog, played by Tom Atkins. And Nick Castle is the first Michael Myers.
Yeah.
And then Tommy Lee Wallace is a real life person who's the actual producer. And I think he's a screenwriter. And I think he's a director too. He worked with, John Carpenter on the first Halloween. And then I think he didn't want any part of part two. He didn't like the script for it, but then I think he came back for part three. And part three has, her name was Nancy Loomis. She was married to Tommy Lee Wallace in real life. She is in Halloween. She's one of the friends of Jamie Lee Curtis's that gets killed. Uh-huh. And then she is the only actress to be in all three Halloween movies, including the third one that has nothing to do with Michael Myers. And then I didn't know this, but Jamie Lee Curtis has a guest video, a voice, she's a telephone operator in Halloween 3. Like, and I never knew that. Like, I think they call for help or something. They get her on the phone. It's Jamie Lee Curtis. Mm. It's her voice on the phone. You never see her, and you'd never know that, you know. But that's like a trivia about that movie. But they go, there's the man that's killed at the beginning. Okay. There's these like robots, people that look, they're like businessmen, you know, and you see a whole bunch of them at the beginning, and that's who kills the old man at the beginning. He pokes it. He's in the, he's in the hospital room, and the guy comes in and puts his fingers through his eyeballs. So it's pretty gross. I can't, there's parts of that movie that I have never seen to this day because it's, the effects are gross, especially with the snakes and the spiders and stuff. But the man is, that man's murdered, and his daughter shows up to try and figure out what happened to him. And then she hooks up with Tom Atkins. And then they go up to Santa Mira, which is the little town that the Silver Shamrock factory's at. And then they go, they meet up with that Colonel Coughlin, and there's some other people that are staying at a hotel that they're staying at that end up going up there for orders too. They have little like stores and stuff that sell those costumes. So that's, I don't know how much of the movie I should tell, you know, it's like, but I like it because, well, they kill, I mean, they don't really tell you what his motive is. Like this, all the people that work there are robots. They're not real people, you know? And then he can turn, you know, real people into a robot too, you know? So they don't really go into that too much. And I was hoping that you had seen it because I was going to ask you, like, there's this one scene with this big giant rock. It looks like Stonehenge in it. And I don't know what that actually had. I've seen this movie so many times, but I've still don't know what that actual part of it means. And I was trying really hard this last time I watched it to figure out what they were doing, because I guess it gives off energy or something. And maybe it helps, you know, power the computers, you know, that they use in it. But see, this movie, I think, was made in 1983. And it was way before like the internet came along and everybody was on computers and stuff. I mean, I think it's kind of before its time, you know. Like, it, you know, the beginning of the movie, how Halloween comes on, usually comes on with an actual pumpkin that's carved, you know, and then they like kind of zoom in, and the way that it, you know what I mean? Well, then this one comes on with like a computer screen, and it's a pumpkin face on a computer screen, and you'll see like the little edge of the mouth and the eye, and it's like, and that's how it comes on, and it's like kind of like high tech for its time. You know, because that's the early 80s. People didn't have personal computers, you know, home computers, you know, so that's what kind of made that. And the fact that somebody could kill you with a computer, you know, like, because the little disc in it had a little shamrock, like their trademark on it. And once they were going to play, they kept previewing, kept doing the commercial. I don't know if you remember the Silver Shamrock commercial.
I don't. I want to watch the movie again now that you're talking about it.
They go, 8 more days to Halloween, 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 8 more days to Halloween, Silver Shamrock. You never heard that?
I don't remember it.
That was like these little munchkins or something we're singing, you know? So they kept counting it down throughout the movie, and then you knew that it was going to be on Halloween night. Well, that's where they have the preview of the first Halloween. Is like they're doing a real movie within a movie of the same person, which is cool, you know. Like they're saying, you know, on Halloween night, you know, the night he comes home, you know, like how they do that with the Halloween movies. They're like, oh, it's at 9 o'clock at night, so they're saying in that movie that you know, on Halloween they're going to be playing, you know, the original Halloween, you know. And then to stay tuned, because I guess there's some kind of giveaway or something, and they want all the kids to stay tuned and watch the commercials in between, and then that's when they're going to play this Silver Shamrock thing. Well, then the thing is this flashing pumpkin, and when that flashing pumpkin activates the thing in the mask, then it splits everybody's faces apart, and they make Tom Atkins like watch this they do a trial run, I guess, on it, you know. And you know, this little, they have this family in a pretend room, you know, and they start playing it on the TV, and it's like, it just, and then these snakes pop out of the kid's head, and you know, he's got a pumpkin mask on, so he's got a pumpkin head. You know? Yeah, so yeah, it's just, it's creepy, you know. And I love the little town that it's filmed in. There's, you know, there's a lot of, like, I was reading like some other trivia about it too, like that Nancy Loomis that's in it. Yeah, she was, I don't know if I said she was married to Tommy Lee Wallace in real life. he's the producer. Like everybody was like kind of linked together, you know, like through the John Carpenter, you know, movies, yeah. You know, so that's kind of cool, you know. And then Tom Atkins was like in The Fog. Nancy Loomis was in The Fog. Only she didn't. Nancy Loomis played Tom Atkins' wife in Halloween 3. So his ex-wife, like they're and then Stacey Neelkin, she plays the daughter of the man at the beginning, you know, that hooks up with Tom Atkins in it. And I haven't seen her in too many things. I think she's in a an early 80s movie called Up the Academy. You ever see it? Ever heard of it? It's from like 1980. Yeah. But I picked it because it's so different than all the other Halloween movies. It's like its own movie.
Right.
Like, yeah. So and I love, there's this like one scene in it where the kids are walking against a sunset, like, and you see the silhouette of their costumes, and it just looks really cool.
Yeah.
So, I don't know if you remember like
the costume. I remember that scene, yeah.
Yeah. I actually, when I was in high school, I was in the art club, and we had to pick a window downtown to like paint a mural on it, and my group painted a scene like that. And so I always thought of that movie, even though I wasn't even thinking of that movie when I was doing that. You know, it's like later I realized, like, maybe I got the idea subconsciously or something, but it's like, it's such a cool scene. You know, it's like, it reminds me of like the Poltergeist movies and stuff. Like when you see like the little suburbs and stuff of the, like, you know, like how Steven Spielberg always used like these, like, you know, these houses, like neighborhoods and stuff. And you see kids going trick or treating, you know, with group kids. You know, and it just seems like, I don't know, I like, there's something about it, that like the trick-or-treating scenes and stuff, I like that. So, but I highly recommended it. If nobody, if you're looking for Michael Myers, he's not in it. So except for the preview for the movie.
I'll watch it this week for my 31-day thing.
I'll watch it?
Yeah, I will.
Okay. I'll find Pumpkinhead. We'll reverse.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll do the reverse. I'll watch Pumpkinhead the night, if I can get it. I'll watch Pumpkinhead the night you watch Halloween 3. And then we can be like, okay, you know, that's our, you know, we traded places.
Okay, Lisa, I want to talk about the TV series Struck by Lightning. It came out in 1979. I think we were in like, what, the sixth grade? 1979? Sounds about right.
11 years old, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, but, I was in seventh grade. I was in seventh grade in 1980. Yeah.
This fall on CBS, you'll meet a strange country inn caretaker.
Frankenstein
of the monsters.
Jack Elam stars in Struck by Lightning, new this fall.
This is CBS.
Did you ever see Struck by Lightning?
Nope, never heard of it.
All right. You missed out, girl, because this is going to be up your alley, okay?
Okay.
If you take the TV series Newhart, where Bob Newhart had the bed and breakfast.
Yeah, which I would love
to. You mix it with the story of Frankenstein, then you have Struck by Lightning. Okay? Do you remember it now? No?
Nope.
Okay. It was about this science school teacher who finds out a distant relative passed away and left him this bed and breakfast somewhere in the New England area. And the teacher goes and looks at it. And the bed and breakfast, one thing in the relative's will is that he has to keep on the caretaker of the property. He has to keep him on employed. He can't get rid of him. Well, the caretaker's name is Frank. And it's this big old man. He's got like one big eye. And anyway, long story, it's Frankenstein's monster is Frank, okay? And Dr. Frankenstein lived in this old bed and breakfast, and his laboratory is in the basement. So this teacher, who's a science teacher, he's reading through Dr. Frankenstein's old journals, and it's fascinating to him. So he wants to move there, run the bed and breakfast as his job. But then at night, he goes down in the basement to Frankenstein's laboratory, and he continues his experiments. And it's a sitcom. It's not scary or anything.
Okay.
And it's pretty funny. And the guy that played Frank was Jack Elam. Do you remember Jack Elam? He's been in a lot of Westerns. He had that one bulging eye, older guy. Cannonball Run. He was He was the doctor who picked up. Yeah. Okay, he played Frank. Okay, who was Frankenstein's?
Oh, he was Coco. Yeah.
So anyway, that's basically what the story was about, and I enjoyed it. And it only lasted like half a season, and it got canceled. And I'll tell you why it got canceled. Okay. My parents figured out the best way to punish me when I was a kid was to take away my television. All right. Uh-huh. And I made a bad grade on a test in school, and they took the television away on the night that Struck by Lightning was coming on. Okay. And I was heartbroken, and I looked so forward the whole week to it, okay? And they took it away, so I didn't get to see it that night. So that's why they canceled the show, you know?
Oh, no.
Their number one fan didn't get to see that one episode. So they canceled the show, you know? So it was all my fault. Well, actually, it was my parents' fault that Struck by Lightning got canceled.
Darn. Well, I like that. I think we should bring it back. I think we should have a...
Yeah, it was an awesome show, but it reminded me of kind of like Newhart. You know, he had the bed and breakfast, or they call it the inn, and people would come and sign in. So each week you had different guests that came and stayed at the inn. Okay. And and he had to keep hiding the fact that he had a secret mad scientist lab and Frankenstein's running around, you know, the monster. But I loved it. It was a good show.
Do you only remember it from memory, or do they put it out on DVD or anything?
Not that I know of. I just remember watching it when I was in the sixth grade.
Oh, have you looked it up online and looked to see like if there's bootlegs of it or anything?
I have not, but I'd like to see it again.
Yeah, me too.
I can't even remember who the guy was that played the main Dr. Stein, who was the name of the teacher.
Yeah, it sounds cool.
Yeah.
Did you say what year it came out?
79, I think.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh, I want to see it. Yeah.
Check it out.
Yeah.
You'll like it because it has the bed and breakfast, or, you know.
Yeah, it's all of that. Yeah, it's all Halloween, bed and breakfast. Yeah, put it all together. Put it in a blender. Yeah. Okay, so my, I can't add to that because I've never seen it. So, now I want to see it. And that's what you do is you make me want to see all these shows and you can't find them anymore. My show was Sigmund and the Sea Monsters.
Sigmund, you are a rotten sea monster.
Sigmund, you're through.
Scram, get out of here.
You do have seen that, right?
Yeah, I remember watching that. Yeah, it had Johnny Whitaker.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So, Johnny Whitaker, Johnny and Scott are these two little boys, okay? And they find Sigmund. I think they find him. He's maybe half drowned or something. They find him on the beach.
Right.
He's trying to escape his dysfunctional sea monster family.
Yeah, they kicked him out.
Yeah, because he wouldn't scare people.
Yeah.
Did you know that? He wouldn't go around scaring people, and that, and
the so friendly sea monster.
Yeah, it was one of the Croft shows, and it was from 1975 to 1978, and then in 78 it was picked up and put on the Croft Superstar shows.
Yeah, I remember that.
To 85, which I don't remember it that long, because that would make Johnny and Scott like teenagers by then, you know, because they were probably. I remember I had this huge crush on Scott when I was probably 7 or 8 years old when it came out. So he was maybe eight or nine. And then Johnny Whitaker was maybe, I don't know, 11 or 12 he looked like in that. And the thing is that they were brothers, And I don't know where their parents were, but they were never home. And they never, they were like gone for the summer and left them in the care of like this housekeeper that was played by Mary Wicks. And they, and even later, the parent, you never saw the parents. The parents never came back. So I guess, I don't know if they left them there with her or what they did, but they, you never see them. And Margaret Hamilton, that was the witch on The Wizard of Oz, she is the neighbor lady in it. I don't know if you remember that.
I didn't realize that.
Yeah. And Johnny and Scott, they have this really cool clubhouse, which I was all into clubhouses back then too. So like we always had clubhouses and my brother would trash them all, but yeah, we'd try and have one for about a day and then he'd find it and smash everything. But even when we allowed him to be in it, it's like, I could see if my brother, you know, we kept him out of our club, you know, but he was, you know, I don't know what his deal was, but I just thought they had the coolest clubhouse, like a beach clubhouse. And they would hide Sigmund there because his brothers, he had a brother, one was Slurp and one was Blurp. Their last name was Ooze.
Right.
And then that was Big Daddy and Sweet Mama Ooze was his parents. And they had a pet lobster and his name was Prince. Do you remember that?
I do.
Do you remember like they had a seashell for a telephone?
Yeah. Yeah.
The seashell.
I remember Johnny Whitaker singing in just about every episode.
Yeah, he did. And he always sang about like his feelings, like whatever he was thinking about, like, you know, whatever was going through his mind right then. Later on, it might have been about a girl or something, but it was usually just life. And I love the opening, the Sigmund and the Sea Monster song, theme song. I love that song. It's pretty cool. Johnny Whitaker actually was in a movie that he played my actual uncle in a movie. I don't know if you know that, but
you told me that before. Yeah.
Snowball Express.
You told me about it. Yeah.
On my uncle's life story. Yeah. His family story. And Johnny Whitaker played my uncle Jay in the movie. So
that's cool.
But Johnny Whitaker was like in a lot of stuff.
Tom Sawyer. Like, yeah.
And what was he?
Tom Sawyer. Yeah. He played Tom.
I didn't know that.
You remember that one?
Family Affair.
Yeah, Buffy and Jody.
Yeah. But the whole Croft shows like back then, I loved them. And they were real people. That was played my phone's ringing. Billy Barty was in the Sigmund costume. And then somebody else did his voice. But you remember Billy Barty was in lots of stuff back then?
It sounds familiar, the name though.
He was a dwarf, you know. So he was in a bunch of like spooky stuff. He might have even been in a horror movie. He might have been, I don't know. But you'll know, you know who he
was. He an older guy back then?
Billy Barty.
Yeah.
He always had like a squinty eye, you know. And
older when we were kids?
Yeah,
I remember him wearing like a fedora in a scary movie. He had like a fedora on and he was going around a haunted house.
Yeah, he always like just squinted his eye and talked like.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, well, he was in the Sigmund outfit, you know.
Oh, that was okay.
Yeah, so I mean,
they rebooted Sigmund the Sea Monsters like in the 90s or early 2000s or something.
I did not know that. Yeah.
It wasn't any good, but they tried.
You know, the first set season of Sigmund and the Sea Monsters, a light caught on fire and burned the set down. They lost like all the entire the set. So, in part season two, they didn't have hardly any set. You know, I don't know what they did with like everything got burned, like the costumes, everything.
Oh wow!
So, yeah, I mean, I read that, but. They must have. I mean, I remember watching it mainly when I was really little. You know, it's like, I mean, like when I was like 7, 8, you know. And so if they did it clear into 1985, I'd have been in like 11th grade. So Johnny and Scott would have been like grown up. So unless they recast them, I don't know. But I couldn't believe it. I never watched it in the 80s. So I didn't know they did that. I just thought it was a late 70s show. You know,
did they keep it going or did they just show reruns on the Croft Super Show?
I don't know, because that's what they did with ISIS. It just went off. It was only on for two seasons and then it went into syndication.
Yeah.
And they just replayed it for like a couple of years.
I know in the late 90s, Croft put out action figures. They had Sigmund. They did Electra Woman and Dinah Girl.
Yeah.
Stuff like that.
I have Electra Woman, and I have the Electra Woman action figure.
That's cool.
I do. And I've seen the Sigmund and the Sea Monsters, and they have a lunchbox, too, for them.
Yeah.
They had a lot of, like, merchandising back then. And all these things like that, like, they could have made really cool costumes. You could have probably made a Sea Monster costume, you know, out of some rags. You know, like some green rags, and just like tied them all, you know, all over your head. You know, it's like been held, you know, held up a stuffed lobster or something, and yeah, it'd have been good. You know, or just if you lived in the swamp or something, you could get some algae and dump on your head, and you know, it's like be a sea monster. But yeah, so yeah, I loved it. So I made my son watch it when he was younger too, and he loved it too. So. They don't make shows like that. They don't make live action, you know, with people for Saturday morning. They just don't do it anymore. So it's a bummer. But if people haven't seen it, I know it's on DVD because I have the whole, I have the entire season. Every episode of the first season, I have it. Yeah. So anyway, yeah. Do you have anything to add to Sigmund?
No, you covered all of that.
Covered all that. Okay. Yeah, you know what? He was, they found him at Dead Man's Point. I remember that. That's where they found him, along the beach.
Dead Man's Point.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Along the beach. He washed up. Yeah. And I just remember this. I remember this one episode with a police car. Okay. With the two brothers, Blurp and Slurp. They see that, they think it's a person. They think it's another monster. Okay, they think the car is a monster, and so they go up to that car and they're like, they think it's a girl, you know, and I don't know why, I forget why, because it's shiny and like pretty, and they're like, ooh, you know, and then the siren goes off, and they're like, she's a screaming banshee, you know, and it's like, and it's the way they talk, it's like, it's so funny, like, I just remember it was really. Like a good comedy, you know, it's really funny, you know, and they would fall on their heads, and it like they would try, you know, scooch around, you know, in their little you know, monster feet, you know, which were like tentacles, because they were like octopuses or something. I don't know what they were. I don't know what they were. They were sea monsters. Like a pile of seaweed, yeah, and with little tentacle feet. And then you could see them shuffling around. Yeah. You know, you could know that there was a person in there. And then sometimes they trip on stuff and they'd fall over and trip on each other, you know, and then roll down the hill or something. You know, it's like, and then you think, that poor person in there, they probably, somebody had to come pick them up and prop them back up, you know, because you couldn't see, you wouldn't have been able to see. But it was, I don't know. I thought it was so funny. And even now as an adult, when I've watched it, you know, when I was watching it with my son, it's like, I still thought it was hilarious. You know, it's like, because it was just so cute, you know, and I just thought, like, the lobster that was their pet, like a pet dog, like, that is so cute. I mean, it's adorable. Like, kids today would think it was cute. I mean, I don't think it would be dated, because they're sea monsters, you know what I mean? They're not like, you know, they're not like, you know, you don't really see, like, you wouldn't really, there's sea monsters, not like they're wearing, you know, 70s clothing, or, you know what I mean, it's like, it would still be cool, I think, but kids probably wouldn't like it, but I loved it. So what's next?
I want to talk about 1983's music video by Michael Jackson, Thriller. Because that's the thriller. Do you remember when you first saw it?
Yes, I do.
Did you see it when it originally aired for the first time, like the premiere? Yeah, me too.
Yep.
That was awesome.
Yeah, because there was a lot of buildup to it.
Yeah, it was. I remember I just could not wait to get home and watch that, you know, and just turned it on early, you know, waiting, and it came on.
Yeah. Because Michael Jackson had done, like, Beat It and Billie Jean and all those first. And even like Beat It, like the like they were like little mini movies,
Right. You know? I like that a lot. Yeah.
And that's what a lot of the like 80s, you know, videos were. They were all like a mini movie. And you just don't see that now. They don't put that effort into a video, a music video. There's not even a song, you know, out. But Thriller is like, I mean, yeah, you have to play Thriller for like Halloween, you know, I mean, you have to. Like, it's the perfect song.
Now, I don't know the stats, but wouldn't you say it's probably the most successful music video ever? I feel that way.
It's one of the most expensive ones.
Yeah.
And it was the longest, because wasn't it almost half an hour long?
But I think everybody was waiting, anticipating to watch it.
Yeah, because they have that the whole scene of them in the movie theater, like watching a movie, and then they go out. Yeah. And the girl that's the actress in it, I know my friend James met her in real life. She was in 10 to Midnight. I don't know if you ever saw that with Charles Bronson. Yeah, she's one of the nurses in that movie.
Okay.
And it's just so cool, like the special effects when he turns into the wolf.
Are you all right?
Get away!
Well, you know, Michael Jackson watched American Werewolf in London.
Yeah.
And he loved that movie. So he contacted John Landis, who wrote and directed that movie, to come help him write and to direct the music video. So that's who did it. But
and Rick Baker.
Yeah, Rick Baker, the effects guy, he came on. And you know, Michael Jackson was supposed to turn into a werewolf. But Rick Baker said, you know, I'm tired of doing werewolves. He said, let's do a werecat. So that's why he kind of looks cat-like. He's got the cat eyes and stuff.
Like cat people.
Yeah, so he made a werecat.
I didn't even know that.
That was pretty awesome.
Yeah.
If anybody listening doesn't know who Rick Baker is, he's one of the top special effects monster guys. You know, he did the Gorillas in the Mist. Did that.
He did Harry and the Hendersons.
Yeah, he worked on the movie and the TV series for Harry. Yeah. Did a lot of stuff. Men in Black, it's pretty cool.
Yeah. Had a
big career.
Yeah.
And he's still out there making movies. So
yeah.
Big time effects guy. But yeah, they had a good team working on this with Rick Baker and John Landis.
Yeah, so. I loved that video. I remember it. When it came on like Friday Night Videos, you know, it was because it was so long, it took up you know, like the whole show just for Thriller, you know, and Vincent Price does the voice, of the Thriller, you know, right. Yeah.
That added a lot to it. That was really cool.
Yeah. Did you see when they, did you see This Is It?
I'm not sure.
Documentary on with Michael Jackson when he was going to go back on tour right before he died?
No, I didn't.
You never saw that?
No.
Because they had totally rebooted Thriller. And they had like a mechanical Black Widow spider in it. And they had redone like the set for Thriller. And they had upgraded it with like all these CGI effects and stuff. But then they had like, they had just, and then they were actually incorporating the Black Widow into the stage. Like a Black Widow spider would come up out of the stage and like come, and it would, and I think maybe a person was inside it and popped up out of the spider too, I think. But it was like they were redoing Thriller, like to kind of update it, you know, and they didn't really wreck it. You know what I mean? Like how when they redo stuff, it's like they take away from the whole thing. But they put like some ghosts and stuff in it, and the graveyard scene, like the graveyard scene in Thriller, when they're coming through the door in the house and then they start dancing and all that stuff. Because, you know, I used to know the Thriller dance, you know, me and my girlfriend. But those were some creepy looking zombie people, you know, dead people, and the effects on that. And then the one where like it was oozing stuff out of his mouth like blood, you know, and I mean I can picture that that video perfect. You know,
I think that dance that you're talking about, that is so embedded in pop culture now. Everybody, young people, everybody knows that dance. Say Thriller, that's the first thing that comes to your mind.
Yeah, they start.
And, I know there's a lot of groups around Halloween that perform that dance, like here in Lake Charles, out in the streets, they do the dance a lot on Halloween. And that red jacket that Michael Jackson wore, that's just a pop culture classic.
Leather, jacket, yeah. Everything. Yeah.
Now, did you hear the story about right before the video was released? Because Michael Jackson was a Jehovah's Witness, the church told him, do not release this video. Michael Jackson sent his assistant to go destroy all the copies of it and not release it. But the production team, they knew that he was doing this, so they hid a copy of it in the vault and so in somebody's office that they didn't find. But if they wouldn't have hid it, we would have never seen Thriller. It would have been completely destroyed because the church was going to kick Michael Jackson out if he released it. So after, you know, they hid it, he couldn't find it. It gave him time to talk some sense into him. And that's why that disclaimer is at the beginning of the video saying, I do not condone whatever it says, the occult.
Yeah.
That he talked to the church and all that afterwards. And they said, you know, if he puts that on there, then he could do it. So
I never knew he.
But we almost did not see Thriller. It almost got destroyed. All that money into it and everything would have just been wasted.
Yeah, it was the most. It was millions of dollars.
Yeah,
and that was a lot of money for.
But he sent an assistant to get all the copies and burn them.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, see, I didn't know. Like I said, I didn't know he was a Jehovah's Witness. I never heard that ever. I never heard he was that. I knew Prince was, but I didn't know Michael Jackson was. Yeah. I never knew that. So, yeah, well, it's weird. Like, okay, so you want me to talk about my music person?
Yeah.
Do you have anything else to add to Thriller?
Just that it's awesome.
Oh, yeah, okay, yeah, it is awesome. Yeah, I had it in my jukebox. I always play it at Halloween. It's a great Halloween song, you know. So my pick for my music person was Billy Idol. So, because all his songs sound like they should be part of Halloween, like Eyes Without a Face, yeah. Flesh for Fantasy, you know, Rebel Yell, you know, and he looked like something that was out of a horror movie. So, and I was thinking about that because, like, I was thinking about who could I talk about, you know, for music, because it's either for Halloween, it's got to be either Billy Idol or Ozzy Osbourne, you know. So, and Billy Idol is still around, he's 64 years old. You know, and he's got two kids, and his son's name is Willem Wolf Brode, because Billy Idol's real last name is Brode. That's who he was born. You know, he's English. So, but he's still out there rocking, you know. So I don't know if you're a fan or not.
I was a big fan of his.
Billy Idol, yeah. And I'm thinking, like, you know, him and like Cyndi Lauper and Boy George, those people, they look like they are wearing a Halloween costume on a regular day.
Yeah, I had a friend in high school that would dress like him.
Yeah, with the blonde hair, the punk hair. Yeah,
the leather and the chain with, you know, the wallet. He had his, like, wallet with the chain on it. And
yeah.
He would kind of dress in the spiked hair and stuff. But, yeah, I liked all of the music and everything, like you're talking about. He's pretty cool.
Yeah, I liked him. His videos were really weird. I mean, they were bizarre, you know, like eyes without a face, you know, you just see his head, you know, it's like, but then, it had all, you know, girls, tons of girls in leather and stuff. Yeah. And
I spend so much time believing all the lies, keep the dream alive. Now it makes me sad, it makes me mad.
on the S&M side, you know, and it's like everybody's leather and wearing chains and stuff, you know. It just it's like I think he's the only one that could pull that off, you know.
I like he had that kind of like Elvis, he had that curled lip when he would sing. Mm. Yeah, that Billy Idol, yeah. And he would always do his fist at the camera, you know.
Oh, yeah, he did.
Yeah. But yeah, I think it's cool. Yeah. I really like this stuff. Did you ever see or hear he did a cover of what's the song at the end of Breakfast Club?
Don't You Forget About Me?
Yes. Billy Idol did a cover of that. It's really good. I like it.
Won't you come see about me? I'll be alone dancing and you know it, baby. Tell me your troubles and doubts, giving me everything inside and out.
Y'all look for that.
I remember he went into I think Rock the Cradle of Love. Do you remember that video?
Yeah.
And he sang Moni Moni. You know, he did a lot of songs. White Wedding.
White Wedding, yeah.
Yeah, we played it at my wedding. White Wedding and Moni Moni. Yeah, I remember dancing to it at my wedding. The Billy Idol version, you know? Mm. So it's just, yeah, it's like Moni Moni. Wasn't that Tommy James and the Shondells? Yeah, originally it said that's the strange crossover to Billy Idol, you know.
Yeah, the wedding singer. Did you watch that Adam Sandler movie?
Yeah, he had a cameo in it.
Yeah, he's on the airplane.
Yeah, but yeah. He broke his leg or something back then too, and had a cane that he wanted to walk. When I think he wrecked his motorcycle actually, and he broke his leg, and he had his leg. He had to get a pin in his leg and stuff, and he was out of commission for a while. Yeah. So, but he's still going, and I was thinking about how he could have been a Halloween costume too, you know. Yeah. I mean, you had dressed up like Billy Idol, you know. I was thinking that about a lot of the music people of the 80s could have been Halloween costumes. Prince could have been a costume. Michael Jackson was definitely a costume, you know what I mean? It's like Cyndi Lauper, you know. Just about anybody could have been a costume back then. Everybody was like totally outrageous, and they had their hair like Cyndi Lauper. I mean, her hair was like red and yellow, and you know, she wore these crazy clothes. Madonna could have been a Halloween costume. She wore all the lace and the, you know, the crucifixes and the.
I remember in high school, people were dressing like Madonna. I don't know. You went to, you know, in punks the. Did people dress up like that, their normal wardrobe?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, because I remember in high school, girls wearing stuff like Madonna.
We
had this one guy, he would dress like the guy from Flock of Seagulls. He had that haircut like that.
Yeah, that could have been
like leg warmers and stuff. And then my friend that dressed like Billy Idol. I mean, our school, we had a very small school. But like our graduating class was like 60 maybe.
Yeah.
People. So, you know, it's a very small school, but a lot of flavor, you know.
Yeah. What's your.
What I was going to talk about Garbage Pail Kids, the sticker.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Did you ever have those?
Yeah, I did.
I'll tell you this. I was looking them up and it said they came out in 1985, but I could have sworn I had them like in 1980, like in junior high and stuff, but.
Yeah.
I must be thinking of some other stickers back then, but I could have swore they were Garbage Pail Kids because, you know, I don't remember in high school having a bunch of them, but I remember them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe, so
because you're getting too old, to collect stuff, mainly when you're 12, 13.
Yeah.
That'd be, you know, yeah.
But I remember having some and I thought they were cool. The creepy names and stuff, you know, Adam, it had Adam Bomb. That was his name instead of Adam Bomb. You know, it was stuff like that. But They came out in 85, and it was made by the people that made the baseball card stuff, like Topps is the name of it, Topps Trading Company. Trading Company. Well, they got sued because they it was basically a parody of the Cabbage Patch Kids.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And anyway, the Cabbage Patch Kids, whoever manufactured that, they sued Topps. And they won their suit, but they settled out of court with Topps. But I guess they Topps had to pay them, and then they could continue with it because they came out with some other series of the cards. But then in the late 80s, they made a movie, which really sucked. Did you ever see
that? I remember that movie. Yeah. Yes.
Then the next year after the movie, they made an animated series, cartoon.
Okay.
But so it had a lot of life in it. And they're talking about rebooting it now, like a new series.
Uh-huh.
But I thought the cards were fun, you know?
Yeah. I collected, like, there was tons of trading cards back then. I collected, like, the Grease trading cards. But, and they all had gum in them, right?
Yeah.
Stick of gum in them.
The cards were all stickers. Like, a lot of your card sets, you get a bunch of cards and then you get a couple of stickers.
One sticker, yeah. Yeah.
But these were all on cards, but you could peel the stickers off the cards.
Yeah.
And I remember the pictures were kind of gross, you know, they had people with their heads split open and worms crawling out.
They had a slime on them and stuff. And I remember, like, do you remember that can of slime? Do you remember that as a toy? The green stuff in a can. In a garbage can, garbage can.
Yeah, I remember that.
And then there was green slime, and then there was purple slime, and the purple slime had worms in it.
Yeah, I remember that.
You remember that? Because I dumped it on my head one time, and it got stuck in my hair.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's not supposed to, it wasn't supposed to stick to stuff, you know? You just put it in your hand, and you let it run down through your fingers. You know what I mean? That's slime. It is the coolest stuff. It would get dirt on it, and it'd have it get crud all stuck to it. Like, whenever you rolled it around in, you know, like, and hair and stuff would get in it, you know, and then eventually it would dry out and stuff. But when you got, like, a fresh can of it, it was, like, it was real, it was oozy, and like, you just, like, let it run through your fingers, and, put it on the table, you know, it's like, and let it, look like you spilled it, you know, like, yeah. That kind of reminds me of the Garbage Pail Kids because it was in a garbage can. You know, it came in a garbage can and it was like ooze, you know, slime. Yeah. So
I remember
these
cards were they were banned in a lot of schools. They said it caused a lot of trouble. Like, the kids were so focused on those cards and showing, you know, like, they had them on their notebooks and stickers and showing them to each other in class and stuff, and it just was a big distraction.
Oh.
A lot of schools, they wouldn't let kids have them.
I wonder if people dressed up for them for Halloween, you know?
I remember some of the pictures. There was one kid, I want to say he was drinking, like, out of a milk carton, and he had all these holes in him, and the milk was pouring out. Yeah, they were all kind of gross-looking pictures.
Yeah, they were gross.
Yeah.
They were really gross. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I remember the Cabbage Patch Kid craze.
Yeah, my mom had one of those.
I remember my cousins bought them, and, you know, they didn't pay the electric bill, but they went and bought Cabbage Patch Kids. You know, it's like, you know, and they never touched them. They never took them out of the box, never played with them.
Well, my mom wanted one, and she took it out of the box and put it on our the mantle of our fireplace in the living room.
Oh. Yeah. I didn't like them. They think they were just as creepy.
Yeah, she liked it.
Oh, I see. I didn't know what the big deal was with them. You know, they were weird looking. I mean, except that they were all supposedly original. You know, like, they were one of a kind.
Right.
You know, so the only one that kind, that one, whatever you got, you know, is like nobody else had it. So that's the. I guess that was the. You know, the thing that made them so popular. I guess, you know, so they were unique, but they were like $50 a. And people bootlegged them and would buy them and then, you know, like, scalp them, you know. Yeah. I mean, sell them like scalpers, not scalp the Cabbage Patch Kids, but, you know, get it. Yeah. So anyway, want to add any more to the garbage pail?
No.
People? Garbage pail people? Okay. But then my extra thing that I wanted to talk about was just the costumes of the 70s and 80s. And, you know, I was thinking about this the other night, how we always made our costumes, you know, me and my brother, like, you know, just get a sheet and make a ghost.
Yeah.
Or just like, I wore my mom's ballet outfit one time, you know, like when she did tap dancing. And if you had a bandana, you could be a pirate, you could be a gypsy, you know. Yeah. Gypsies were really cool, like back in the 70s. You know, it's like you could put some hoop earrings on and a bandana on and like a frilly skirt or like a shawl, you know, and it's like, and go as a gypsy. You didn't have to go buy a costume, but those plastic Ben Cooper costumes.
I love, you know? Ben Cooper stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. That's what this is. This. See this?
Yeah. Pretty cool.
You know who that is?
Billy Idol.
That's not Billy Idol. Yeah. The Mighty Isis.
Oh, Mighty, yeah. Isis. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So I bought this later in life. I was never ISIS. I was ISIS for Halloween. But I didn't wear the mask. I made a amulet, and I had an ISIS t-shirt on, and I put white, I had white jeans on, and then I did my hair like her. I was ISIS one year for Halloween, but I was a grown up, so it wasn't as a kid. But just about every single show on TV, you could have found a Ben Cooper, like plastic, like the Halloween costume, like from like Land of the Lost.
Oh, right. They made the flea stack. Yeah.
Yeah. They made everything.
They were cheap too.
Yeah. Like $2.99.
Yeah.
$1.57 or something like that. Yeah. Yeah. And it's like, yeah. And then these plastic, you know, eyeballs like cut into your skin. You know, made marks in your face.
Yeah, and that elastic band that would always break, that string, string.
Yes, it did break.
I'd always have to tie it in knots to keep it on. You know?
It broke when I was doing something with it earlier.
Yeah.
The plastic bodysuit. You had to wear clothes. You had to wear like long underwear or something underneath it, because the rest, well, down here it was cold.
It was cheap vinyl.
Yeah, so you had to put a little sweatsuit or something on underneath it.
Yeah,
and then put that on, because you couldn't just wear the costume with nothing on underneath it. So you always had like a sweatshirt or something on, and then you got really hot, like it, because Halloween like can go either way. It could be really warm or it could be cold. We've had snow at Halloween here. So, sometimes it was really warm, you know, like for Halloween. And I just remember, my mom's friends came over one time to our house, and they were dressed like Fonzie and Pinky Tuscadero.
Pinky, you know? Yeah.
Yeah. And, if you think back of, like, all the different shows that were on, all the 70s and 80s stuff, every single show, even, like, Grizzly Adams, you could have been a Grizzly Adams, you know? You know, and then Dukes of Hazzard, just like wear a flannel shirt, you know, it's like you could have been any of those things, you know. It's like I was trying to think. I dressed up as a devil one year, and I was in I had a pair of red long underwear, and my dad made me a pitchfork and made it out of an old broom, and like took a piece of cardboard and covered it with like Reynolds wrap, you know, to make like the pitchfork, you know, part. And then I had a devil mask. And then I remember my brother and my cousin, they were clowns that year. And it's like, and I remember being a scarecrow one year, because like that was easy. Just like put shoe polish on your face and made patches on your face and put a hat on, put straw sticking out, put a flannel on. That was easy, you know. Yeah. What, do you remember what any of your costumes were?
I had a lot of those Ben Cooper. I had Evel Knievel, Darth Vader. Spider-Man, Superman, all those. Like the homemade ones. I mean, Indiana Jones in the 80s, you know, when that came out.
Did you go trick-or-treating in the 80s?
Yeah.
How old were you when you stopped trick-or-treating?
I ain't gonna say.
I was 16.
I'm not gonna say. No.
I was 16. I remember I had broken my knee.
I was in junior high probably the last time I went. I'll tell you, when my daughter was little, I would take her and I would dress up too.
Yeah, we did it.
I've always been the Edge Owens. Yeah, one year I dressed up as a Slee Stack.
Did you?
Yeah.
See, I made Jordan. I made him go till he's 14. And I remember the last year that he went, I had to practically drag him out the door. And I was like, if you don't go, you know, then I can't go. And it's like, and then how, you know, what am I going to do? You know, it's like, you're my only kid. You know, it's like, so, you know, and he's like, come on, I'm like 14. And I'm like, and I see like people today that they get mad when they see older kids. But I think it's great. Like, I think if adults wanted to go trick-or-treating, let them. You know, if I had anybody come to my house, I'd be happy. You know, like when I was a kid, we used to get hundreds of people at our house for Halloween. And I remember like we'd run out of candy and my mom would like run to the neighbor's house and see if they had any like leftover candy, you know, because like, or she would start rooting through me and my brother's candy. If we got home before the kids had like stopped coming, she'd be like, I need candy, you know, give me some of your candy. We're like, heck no, man. We just went out like for 3 hours, like trying to get all this candy and you're not touching my candy, you know? So, but I just remember I loved Halloween. I loved trick or treating, you know? And it's just, and I remember even going by myself. Like sometimes I could, like my brother would go off finding a friend or something. Like we would start out together, you know? And then it's like, and then he would take off and, you know, and I don't know if you remember like the neighborhoods you trick-or-treated in and like who gave out the like the coolest, you know, stuff, you know, like I remember a guy that would give out like silver dollars, you know, and the people that gave out the big Hershey bars and the big candy bars, the big size, not the mini ones, you know, and then people used to bake stuff and, you know, but you know, and then you got all the weirdos, you know, doing the putting the stuff in the apples and having to take your, and it got to be like, oh, you have to take your candy to the hospital to have it x-rayed before you can eat it. So it's like, you know, everybody ruins Halloween, you know, so, but yeah, I loved it. It was like my favorite holiday. It still is, you know, so yeah, I'm having a Halloween party, you know, for my girls, you know, so just my ghoul friends, you know, we're going to have a dinner, you know, so, I don't know, you have to tell people what our prize is for
this. Okay, I'll show them.
Oh, show them, okay. I want to see.
Okay, our prize this week, it's a limited edition print. There's only 2,000 of them made, and it's Ghostbusters. And you can only get this through the company called Eagle Moss. And this one's, it's by artist Brian Williamson. It's got like a little certificate in here with it. Brian Williamson. And the name of the print is Here to Save the World. But it shows all the Ghostbusters. And I left the plastic on it so it wouldn't get messed up.
Yeah. Well, what's the code word?
How about Ghostbusters? Is that good?
I think that's a good code word.
Yeah. So send us a private message on our Facebook page saying Ghostbusters, and you'll be entered in the drawing to win this print. I don't know what size. What is this, like an 11 by 14 maybe? The whole, the border and everything?
Yeah.
Probably 11 by 14, 11 by 17, something like that.
Yeah, they can trim that border down to whatever.
Yeah, you can trim it down. But anyway, I think it's really cool looking.
Cool.
And Eagle Mall sells a lot of collectibles. They're like a big company.
I was watching Ghostbusters this afternoon.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. Happy Halloween.
Yeah, happy Halloween. Spiderella.
Hey, Spiderella. I goofed it in the beginning, but that's me.
Well, I want to thank all the listeners for tuning in. And I mean, this is a special we try with the video just for Halloween, but we won't be doing it all the time, but we just want to see how it goes. But I think I liked it. It's fun.
Yeah, it was fun. I had a blast. Yeah.
So anyway, I want to thank everybody for listening in. Make sure you go to our Facebook page, share stuff with us. Like we put up a picture and ask a question. We'd like to see your comments, your pictures, videos, whatever you want to share. Also our website, popninja.net. There's other stuff on there. Just let us know what you think about the show so far. We'd love to hear from you.
That's right.
So
cool. Go to Pop Ninja.
All right. And Lisa, you got a final thought to leave everybody with?
Happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween.
It's almost time, kids. The clock is ticking. Be in front of your TV sets for the horror-a-thon. And remember the big giveaway at 9. Don't miss it. And don't forget to wear your masks. The clock is ticking. It's almost time.
Happy, happy Halloween. 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 Happy, happy Halloween. Silver Shamrock.